Dear guests, welcome to the Adab Festival Pakistan, the first edition of this new literature festival. And also thank you all for coming. Welcome to our honorable guests. Today we are here to discuss the upcoming book by General Fida Malik called Balochistan, A Conflict of Narratives. And we have with us the author himself, General Fida Malik, Ms. Zubaida Jalal, who is a federal minister and also from Balochistan. And then we have with us Mr. Tariq Khosa. I'll just give you a brief bio of our guests. General Fida Malik has been with the Pakistan Army for the last over 30 years. He has been enrolled, commissioned in 1986. He graduated from the Command and Staff College in Quetta and also Defense Inter-Services Staff College in Paris and the French School of War Studies as well as the National Defense University in Islamabad. During his 33-year military service, he has commanded an infantry brigade on the Pakistan-Afghan border as well as working with the Rahe during Operation Rahe Najat, as well as being a part of the UN mission in Ivory Coast. He's been an instructor at the Command and Staff College, Quetta, and subsequently as Brigadier as Operations Plans at headquarters of the Southern Command in Quetta. So he has a broad experience in Quetta, not just as a student, but also having worked in the Southern Command and the Corps headquarters in Quetta. And now he has been with the General Headquarters, but he has over the time found time to write a book on Balochistan because he's worked there a lot. Ms. Zubaida Jalal, a brief introduction. She has been a Federal Minister for Defense Production in the current government. And prior to that, she has been MNA from Balochistan and also served as Federal Education Minister in the Shaukat Aziz cabinet. And she's been a prominent spokesperson for Balochistan and the people of Balochistan. And she's been an activist in the education sector. She has a wide-ranging network of activities in education. Mr. Tariq Khosa is an esteemed bureaucrat. He has been served. He served in the police and the FIA. And he is also has widespread experience in Balochistan. And he retired as Director General FIA. And he is going to be joining us for his comments on General Fida's book. So to begin with, I would just like to hand over the mic to each speaker for as long as they want for an opening statement before we move on to the discussion. So General Sir, would you like to tell us about the book? Where did the name Conflict of Narratives come from, sir?
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mashab. Honorable Madam Amina Sayed, Madam Nadia Ghani, my publisher, all the respected guests on the panel, and respected audience, Assalamu Alaikum. I extend my deep gratitude to the organizers of this event and to you all for your kind presence today. Ladies and gentlemen, the history of Balochistan is characterized by an unending duel of narratives and counter-narratives. Balochistan, the largest yet the least developed province of Pakistan, is home to brave people. This province plays an important role in regional strategic context by virtue of its location at the cusp of Indus, Persian, and Central Asian civilizations. With frontiers adjacent to significant countries like Afghanistan and Iran, Balochistan's proximity with the oil-rich Gulf region, its very long coastline, running parallel to the global sea lines of communications for oil export, and Gwadar being the jewel of China-Pakistan economic corridor, make it even more important. It possesses immense wealth of minerals, and there are strong prospects of oil and gas reserves off the Makran coast in Arabian Sea. Its rugged terrain has guarded the Indus Plain for centuries from the intruders, while its brave people have always defended the motherland with great fervor. Unfortunately, despite being the largest of all the provinces, Balochistan remains the least developed an entire country. Since 1970s, the province has transformed from being a tribal state to the status of a full-fledged province. However, it is still lagging behind its deserved status. Balochistan has been a victim to external belligerence and internal mismanagement, causing many genuine and some perceived grievances. Its strategic significance has attracted the global attention, which subjected Balochistan to hybrid war by the hostile intelligence actions by unfriendly countries. Internally, its development and prosperity has been affected due to negligent policies and vested interests, prioritizing self, tribal, or political interests over the prosperity of Baloch people. From strategic social standpoint, Baloch society still faces challenges like absence of basic amenities and social uplift opportunities, omnipresent insecurity, seditious activities of various outfits and foreign militants. These sufferings had enduring effects and have resulted in inducing psychological trauma and emotional damage to the Baloch community. Having agonizing survival through these turbulent conditions of civic life, emotions of discontent and disgruntlement are quite deeply entrenched now in the society. This phenomenon has carved out a fundamentally weird relationship between the Federation and the province, which requires a sober relook through the social, political, and economic lens for early rectification. Ladies and gentlemen, the state today has realized that the prosperity of Pakistan is contingent upon development in Balochistan. Islamabad has developed and adopted the prosperity for people of Balochistan as its top agenda in Pakistan Vision 2025. The provincial government has also vowed to achieve major benchmarks in line with the same vision. CPEC has emerged as Pakistan's route to prosperity through China Belt Road Initiative, prospects of which are unimagined without Gwadar Port. The day is not far off, inshallah, once dividends of this venture will be available to the people of Balochistan. Ladies and gentlemen, I owe a lot to Balochistan. When I took it upon myself to be the voice of Baloch, I knew I had to be unbiased and passionate to understand what really happened to relations between the province and the Federation. I have chosen to talk less about the geography and more about the prevailing sentiments. I have chosen to mention the cross-cutting narratives, the narrative of Federation vis-a-vis the narrative of the province, narrative of the people vis-a-vis the narrative of those who govern these people, narrative of sub-nationalists, narrative of the militant outfits, and the narrative of the tribal chiefs as well. In my projection of views, I wanted to look unbiased and neutral so that the state can be clearly told that the problem does exist and that it has developed into a malady and in a serious situation, and that it requires an urgent attention. Let me confess that despite having served in Balochistan for a very, very long time, my understanding of the problems confronting the province would not have been complete if a few prominent personalities like Mrs. Zubeda Jalal Khan, Senator Mir Hasel Bezinjo, Sardar Akhtar Mengal, Mr. Awais Ghani, Lieutenant General Retired Alam Khan Khattak, Senator Sanaullah Baloch, and Dr. Shakil Roshan, to name a few, were not willing to share their views and grievances with me in person. I'm also thankful to the Army for letting me write on a topic which is largely perceived as a closely guarded secret by the Federation. Talking of cross-cutting narratives at play in Balochistan was a very challenging task, and I have a great satisfaction in claiming that in the course of compiling these thoughts, I had a very informal and candid discussion with all the prominent personalities from province who were willing to share with me their experiences and thoughts. I can also claim that the reader would find a lot of confessions in this book. Confessions about the wrongdoings and neglects. And I feel that this is the first step towards problem solving, that we have started realizing that the mistakes were committed and that we are ready and willing to rectify them. Thank you very much.
Thank you, General Saab, for your candid comments. We would like to have a more interactive session first, but first I would like to hand over to Ms. Zubaida Jalal for an opening statement.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. And I'd like to thank the organizers, especially my long friend, outstanding friend, Amina Sayed, for giving me this opportunity to be here and to debate on a very critical issue for Pakistan itself. As General Saab just mentioned, basically the book, I'd like to even discuss the book because I was part of that, some of the questionnaires which I have answered. Being someone from Balochistan and who has her soul, mind and heart with Balochistan, I felt that finally we have realized that until we do not discuss and accept the problem that we have, we will never ever be able to move forward towards a resolution of the issue itself. Over the years, historically, there's been a lot of discussion and debate on this issue of federation versus province and the people of Balochistan versus, you know, versus the army or even the people of Punjab itself. In the sense, because the federation predominantly and the establishment and bureaucracy is mostly civil servants of Punjab. The army, when we look at it, maybe 80%, 90 or even more than that, predominantly people serving from Punjab. So the perception was, whenever anything would go wrong, that it's the people of Punjab who are actually making the people of Balochistan suffer, which was not true. As I said, I'd like to discuss a little bit of the book before, and then we leave it for question and answers. The security and socio-political canvas of the province has unfortunately been stained by an unending venomous series of narratives disgorged by various actors directly and indirectly involved in the issue. There is no denying the fact that the province never got its rightful share of attention. And this partly explains the reason behind most of the grievances of the people. But then, are the rights to be given only by the federation itself? Or there is a role and responsibility of the people of Balochistan who are in governance at the provincial level? And aren't they also supposed to give these rights to their own people? This phenomena has entwined a fundamentally flawed relationship between the federation and the province, which needs to be urgently looked through the social, political, and economic prisms. We just heard, and we have been hearing since 2000 and onwards, when the first foundation stone was laid for the Gwadar deep sea port in Gwadar. For the many past years, we have been hearing of CPAC and the potential that it has. Now, how do we work out and ensure the people of Balochistan that Gwadar is as much as they own the CPAC route or whether the Gwadar deep sea port and not only for Pakistan? Gladly, a realization has surfaced for recognition of the issue, as I mentioned, which would certainly result into development of an appropriate problem-solving mechanism. I am glad that this book takes into account the first-hand viewpoint of well-reputed Baloch leaders, as mentioned by General Saab, eventually, and will therefore contribute towards developing a deeper understanding of Balochistan issue, eventually contributing towards a very well-integrated federation-province relationship, which is very, it's high time. I know we've been discussing these issues, but let me tell you that the Balochs are very resilient people. Over the years and centuries, being deprived in spite of not having the basic fundamental rights of Baloches, of human beings within the province that we live, you will find them optimistic, looking towards the federation and the provincial government, and hoping for a better tomorrow for themselves and for Pakistan itself. Until or unless, as I said, we don't accept the problem, I'm glad that we are talking very candidly today. And it's at the same page, whether we are talking on behalf of the army, or we are talking on behalf of the federation, or as someone from that province, we have come to that point where we know that until or unless we do not thrash through these issues, we will never be able to have a peaceful, secure Balochistan and a peaceful, secure Pakistan. So I leave it to that, and we
thank
go
you
towards
for your
and
comments.
Answers.
Before we move on to some questions on your thing, we just have a statement from Mr. Tariq Khosa, sir. Over to you.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me to be on the panel regarding discussion of a book on Balochistan. I take pride in the fact that since creation of the province in 1970, I have been the only Baloch Inspector General of Police in that province. I am also delighted, and I think that a book coming from a serving Major General reflects a glasnost within the armed forces, that they have allowed their serving military officer, who was in front of the firing line, I know it for personally, during 2012 to 2013, when my colleague Inspector General Police, Mushtaq Sukhera, was the Inspector General Police. He as Brigadier worked together along with the law enforcement, and that the situation of violence in Balochistan was at its peak at that time. So from that point of view, it is it's a very pleasant surprise for me that a serving military officer has come up with a book which is very rich in history, and its perspective about Balochistan is worth reading. So he's got lots of research, and he's talked to the people who matter in that province. So this is a very, very refreshing outlook coming from an institution which was, you know, very sensitive about discussion about Balochistan as an issue. Ladies and gentlemen, as a police officer, having served for 4 decades in law enforcement, I'm a firm believer of the fact that we should be very careful in using the terms like terrorists or insurgents. Our own people who may be misguided or due to certain causes would be angry or would have taken on the state should not be dubbed straight away as terrorists or insurgents. So we have to be very careful in using such terminology, whether it's FATA, whether it's other areas in this context. It's not a war. You have to see a situation from a different perspective as to why it is happening. Is it because of the state failure that this is? And recent book of Mr. Kasser Bengali is also, I think, an outstanding, well-researched book, which also should be a must-read by policymakers. Having said that, I think Balochistan is Pakistan's future, and having sub-nations of such a great variety of sub-nations in this country is our strength. So we should look for unity in diversity, and that is where I think. Now, in terms of what's been happening in Balochistan, few points are worth consideration. Let's acknowledge that the London-based self-exiled Khan of Kalat, Mir Suleiman Ahmad Zai, calls China and Pakistan plunderers and leans towards India to help stop or subvert CPAC's execution. He recently told the media that Indian Prime Minister Modi was a friend of Balochistan. Then there is the Baloch Liberation Army, the BLA. Its leader, Harbiar Murray, is based in London. He is trying to create unrest in Bolan Pass area near Quetta and Sibbi. And it is his organization that attacked the residency in Ziyarat also. Similarly, Bramdag Bukti is inciting his followers to play with fire in the Sui and Dera Bukti areas from his cool Geneva haven. Remember, these are Baloch Sardars who, while living in plush European lands, cannot inspire the poor and downtrodden people of Balochistan to follow their diktat. And I'm glad that General Malik has adequately addressed the issue of Sardars versus Sarkar, state versus the chieftains. And that's very important, I think. The real threat to the state agencies comes from the dissident Baloch youth and the Baloch Liberation Front, the BLF leadership, perched in the mountainous terrain around Turbat, Gwadar, Panjgur, and Kharan. A bright middle-class student, Dr. Ala Nazar, started to lead the youthful insurgents in 2006. These angry young Baloch men and women are the ones who require our state security stakeholders' attention. Instead of alienating them, efforts should be made to respect them and listen to their voices of dissent. Their spokesmen are in fact the Baloch politicians who chose the ballot over bullets and contested the 2013 and 2018 elections. These elected leaders are not against Pakistan. If Akhtar Mangal in Supreme Court raised 6 points, these 6 points were not six seeds of secession. These 6 points were drawing attention for provincial autonomy, for status of Balochistan, which is their dueful right. And I think that should not be denied. So overall, this what are their demands? We should be very clear what the Baloch sub-nationalists are demanding. And they reflected this on their 10th of January 2016. There was this multi-party conference on CPAC, which was hosted by Balochistan National Party Mangal in Islamabad. And their points are worth consideration. One, complete control of Gwadar Port mega project should be handed over to the Balochistan in accordance with the constitution. They want within the constitutional parameters. Ownership rights and the power to make decisions concerning Balochistan resources should be accepted. You know, understand the Sui gas history. Number two, the unanimous resolution passed earlier while Nawaz Sharif was the Prime Minister in May 2015 was to be implemented in the context of CPAC's Western route that should be completed first. This was their demand. And why not? The hinterlands, the neglected areas of Balochistan should be given priority in CPAC. Three, steps should be taken to prevent the Baloch from becoming a minority in their province. There should be a complete ban on the issuance of identity cards, local certificates, and passports from Gwadar to new settlers so that their names are not included in electoral list. This was a political demand, of course. Number four, basic requirements of clean drinking water, hospitals, schools, technical colleges, center for skilled persons related to the port, and maritime university. They want a university in Gwadar. It's a Baloch demand. So this is the locals need to be given priority in employment and appointments at the port and mega projects. Finally, they said that in order to prevent local fishermen from economic deprivation, alternate means of earning should be provided. All restrictions on the people of Gwadar, including an unannounced ban on political activities, should be removed, and they should be allowed freedom of movement. These resolutions, these demands, I believe, agreed upon by various mainstream political forces, reflect a consensus that the state should have addressed so that the festering wounds and that have provided impetus to the Baloch insurgency could be healed. My final point before we go on to further discussion is about governance paradigm in Balochistan. Well, there are vast ungoverned spaces in that province. And that vast ungoverned spaces, you see these militants and those violent prone elements take advantage of that and they use it as their havens. So vast expanse of about 90% of B area where the levies or the Sardar's force or militia is in control is practically being looked after by the frontier corps, which should be basically responsible for our border security and other aspects. So therefore, it was a genuine initiative by General Musharraf that he wanted that entire province, all 30 districts of Balochistan, should have one uniform judicial system and should have one uniform law enforcement system. And that was a remarkable, I think, initiative, which was undone by the vested interests after 2008 elections, and the whole process was subverted, and we were back to square one of having these large ungoverned spaces, which is a poor governance paradigm which will have to be addressed from law enforcement perspective. So one is socio-political economic deprivation of the Baloch youth, which must be addressed. And the second is the security paradigm. Thankfully, we have abandoned the kill and dump strategy, which the state had erroneously adopted. And now a stick and carrot approach is being followed, which is producing results, yet I think militarization of internal security strategy in Balochistan will not work. We will have to deal with it through a justice, through a law enforcement, and through a due process paradigm.
Thank
so
you,
that's
sir.
Initially my thoughts on Balochistan's perspective.
Thank you, Khosa Saab. Just wanted to open the discussion to all speakers now. Tariq Saab has just mentioned that, yes, there are a lot of grievances and there are also very specific demands that are coming out of mainstream politicians within the Baloch, you know, political establishment. So, General Saab, you have talked about a conflict of narratives. There are different organizations, different interest groups, different parties, you can say, who have conflicting demands, conflicting narratives. I just wanted you to add on that, based on what Tariq Saab said, that yes, there are some genuine grievances too. So,
yes, I think, as I mentioned in my opening statement also, that unless we recognize and we admit that there are grievances, there have been the wrongdoings, the overall statement of move forward would not be complete. And I have endeavored to admit those wrongdoings and the mistakes which were either committed by the state through its organizations and the institutions, by the security agencies, by the intelligence agencies. So those all have been admitted. But mind you, these were not only the follies of the state, as Dr. Saib also mentioned, that there was a responsibility towards the people of Balochistan also. They also had to perform a few functions. The government institutions also had to perform a few functions. There were failures and sometimes less than the expected standards from that side also. There was a perception which was mentioned by Khosa Saab about the Punjabi army. And I'm glad to mention that this perception has largely been addressed, that instead of having a very large representation from Punjab and Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, now is the time that we are admitting a lot of youth from Sindh and Balochistan as well.
Right.
Not only in the army, but other services like Air Force and Navy, they also have carried out significant steps. They have taken some measures where they have lowered the standards of selection in their branches, respective branches. They accept the low standards of education as well as the physical conditions, so that there should be a degree of integration in the armed forces. And thereupon, once the trend starts, thereafter those standards can again be re-raised to the level of a federal force level. Once I had discussions with the Baloch leadership so as to know the grievances, the roots of these grievances, I chose both the prominent communities living in Balochistan, that is to say the Baloch community and the Pashtun community.
Pashtun communities.
So you would notice in my list of the interviews that I had a long list of interviews from the Baloch leadership, and I had a long list of interviews from the Pashtun leadership as well. If I had interviewed the state institutions or the people representing the state institutions, I also interviewed the people representing the academic institutions also.
Right.
I wanted to take a wholesome view. And as you also mentioned that unless we admit, the state admits, the Federation admits that yes, the mistakes were there, there would be no headway. And I think my endeavor, though I'm not a very prolific writer, but I wanted that I should pen down these observations, these grievances, so that if our generation can take benefit out of these observations, or someone else few years later down the line can take benefit from these observations, we can move towards the better side, we can move towards the silver lining.
Tariq Saab, are you as optimistic as General Saab is that we have actually addressed a lot of our past mistakes?
First of all, I must give credit to the General that he is saying that we must admit our mistakes. This killing of Bukti was the greatest mistake of the state in 2006. Now, Bukti was not against Pakistan. Bukti was entitled to certain royalties, and he was negotiating with the government on that account. And General Musharraf agreed to meet Nawab Bukti in Islamabad. He sent a plane in Sui Airport, and Nawab Bukti was sitting in Dera Bukti waiting to go to Sui and then on to Islamabad to have discussions with General Musharraf in the context of Baloch issues and royalty and other issues. What happened last moment? Nawab Bukti was told that there is a technical fault developed in the plane, so that program is off, and Bukti himself saw that aircraft take off and over Dera Bukti and saw that. Once he knew that the general is not going to talk at the last intervention of certain elements of the state, Bukti's parleys with the government were not going to go on. Bukti headed for a cave in Kolu. And the kind of stubborn person that he was, having known him since my superintendent of police days in early 80s, he had idiosyncrasies. He was a man of his kind. But then, you know, he was open to discussions. And that was denied to him. And once he reached that cave, there was a pounding over that cave. There was a military operation going on. And at unfortunate that day, on the 26th of August 2006, there was a lieutenant colonel and three other army officers who were with Nawab Bukti in that cave, talking to him, trying to persuade him to come out, when that cave caved in because of the pounding overhead. And Nawab Bukti, along with those four military personnel, embraced Shahadat, or they died in that incident. That was a turning point. I think he has gone down in Baloch folklore as, you know, as a hero. So therefore, these are mistakes made at critical points by the state and its handling. And other aspect that I want to talk about is the political engineering done in Balochistan. Anybody, all the Baloch sub-nationalists who are willing to adopt the way of the ballot or the elections should be given their due right. And Ms. Zubeda Jalal will endorse me on this account, that those who contest elections, those who want to be in the parliament or the assemblies, should not be denied their due right. And the political engineering done by the military establishment and the intelligence agencies in Balochistan has been a constant feature of every national election or other provincial elections that have been held. That, I think, is unnecessary. And so right or level playing field must be provided to all the Baloch, Pakhtun, and other elements within Balochistan. The security establishment, somehow this is a strategic region, and there's a new great game being played. And from that angle, we start forgetting about our internal security fault lines and start building a narrative as if, you know, the enemies are after us, and so therefore we are constrained to do these things. So all in all, I think it's the faltry state policies which have led us to this sad state of affairs that Balochistan finds itself in. However, there is a silver lining. There was a non-Sardar Baloch who tried to negotiate with the dissident elements, and he was denied this eventually by our military establishment, Dr. Malik Baloch. And now there is a very enlightened chief minister of Balochistan who means well, who is a pro-development, progressive chief minister. And this new government, I see a ray of hope. And within the security establishment, I see paradigm shift now. They are talking of development. They are talking of taking all the elements along, the political dissidents and all others. There is a stick and carrot approach, no doubt, but they are trying to mainstream as many elements within the
Baloch. As possible. There is
that
definitely
is the silver lining which I feel, and we should be pursued. I see a paradigm shift now.
Yes, you can definitely see certain changes happening, including, as General Saab said, more recruitment of Baloch into the armed forces. I just wanted to briefly touch on one aspect that you mentioned, that you are the only person from Balochistan to have served as IG of Balochistan. So speaking of, the problems and grievances, is that something that we are actively trying to address? Are we meeting any progress in addressing these kind of concerns?
Zubeda Jalal is in a better position to answer that. She is a federal minister. Ji. The Baloch people in federal and provincial bureaucracy must have a primacy. What are we addressing? Is this government addressing the requirements of Baloch in the policy making and other arenas? What do you think?
I'm sure attempts are being made, but I'm...
I'd just like to go back a little bit into history again before I answer your question. You see, the Sardari and tribal system, feudalism as we would call it, and then the people of Makuran versus the people of Makuran. Now in Makuran, when I talk of Makuran, I mean Panjgur, Turbat, which is Kech district, and Gwadar district. We've never had the Sardari system. We do have the notables, we have the elders, we have distinct caste, sort of the elders, and then you have the farmers, you have the craftsmen, and you have the health society, the community. That's how the caste system is in Makuran. Now, for me, when I look back to the history and how it has evolved, there has been a lot of support from the Federation itself and strengthening the tribal system by appeasing the Sardars and Nawabs all through these last 70 years. And when I say appeasing, and when we talk of all those leaders who are in England and who are in Switzerland and who are in Dubai have their other brothers sitting in the government, real brothers in the government, in the province. So you have them on both your sides.
Right.
You know, that's how the game is being played in Balochistan. Until today we have them. It's not that we don't have them. Many of them, Bugti's two grandsons are, one an MNA, one a MPA, in the mainstream federation. Sardar Akhtar, with all due respect to him, in being the MNA and has a brother who's in the part of the paramilitary or whatever, you know, insurgency or whatever you call them. The Murray's sons, two are abroad, Mehran and Khairbiar, and two are part of the system.
Right.
Very much the Nawab, Jangez Murray, was in the last government, a minister. So how do you now balance this out as a state? And how do the Nawabs and Sardars expect us, people who don't believe in this system, to follow them or to believe that they are for us, there for us, for the Balochs? So this is one conflict which is continuously there.
Right.
With this government, let me tell you, and even in Musharraf's government, because I was there, very much part and parcel, in 2002, Dr. Malik was my opposing candidate, and I won the elections, direct elections in 2002. And I call them the so-called nationalists, because we know the ins and outs compared to other provinces and people of the other provinces. So for me, he would go around saying that she was brought in by the establishment, because it was a government, an army government she was part of, came in for direct elections, and this is the perception that went around, that I'm an army person. Accepted, I'm an army person. But when I came into, when I came into the positions that every one of them has gone through, you know, in the political hierarchy, in position as a minister, as chief minister, as minister, federal minister, what was my responsibility then? Wasn't I supposed to cater for the grievances that all through these years have been accumulating, till the extent where, as Tariq Khosa Saab mentioned, in 2006 when everything blew up. But we've gone through these times and periods within these 70 years of Pakistan coming into being many times. It's not the first time. But this time has been the most volatile. The movement has been there since 1950s. The first, you know, I'm repeating myself, but the first time when Noroz Khan and his group of armed, not armed people, but group of people who went to the mountains and demanding to implement the agreement that the accession to Pakistan happened by Balochistan, as a, which was a free state till then.
State
and since then, exactly, state of Kalat. So since then, on and off, we've had these turmoil periods coming in, and I think three or four maybe within these 70 years. But then I always feel very strongly that there was a role I, as a Baloch, when I come in into these positions of authority, I should have played, which our Balochs were not as committed or honest as they should have been.
Should have been. So there is both a federal role as well as a provincial role
in the
Now,
after the 18th Amendment...
I think we're running out of time.
Yeah, yeah.
We need to...
Just after the 18th Amendment, which has happened, there's a lot of things that, you know, not only the social sectors, but even industries are with the provincial governments. if CPAC happened at a time before the sort of before the 18th Amendment Agreement, but we did have reps of the Balochistan government sitting there in the Federation, who could have easily, if they could do the 18th Amendment and devolve it as an all-party, you know, group of people sitting there, they could have easily also looked into the CPAC agreement. They could have easily looked into the RECODEC agreement that we are now very much agitating and going into a loss, because there's going to be a lot of liabilities on us.
Penalty.
A big, huge liability to the government of Balochistan. Finally, I'd just like to add here and mention that now, as the defense minister for Balochistan, for Pakistan, for the defense production minister for Pakistan, we are soon going to start the second shipyard, shipbuilding yard in Gwadar.
In Gwadar, okay.
And now, what does that entail? You see, again, the concerns of the local people of Gwadar, whether this is going to be for us or not, whether it's only just going to be for the Federation and its economic.
Which is always a concern.
Concern for everybody. Already we have been very clear. We are not going to buy land from the government of Balochistan. There's going to be a partnership of equity.
Okay.
You know, and just my single person being there. Nobody's directed me or nobody has asked me to do this. But this is the agreement that is evolving. Technical training, till the such time that it's operationalized, we'll be sending them to all our establishments in Islamabad and in right. Punjab. First job opportunities for them. And there is a small, for the locals, and that is not only for Gwadar, but for Kech, for Panjgur, and other parts of Balochistan. And then also, the agreement is that to a certain level of grades of officers, it will be only Baloch, and then further higher as we go higher. So then because we would need technical expertise, you know,
expertise.
There. So it will be open for Pakistan and maybe the world also. The same thing is going to happen now with the oil refinery that is coming in from Saudi.
Right.
And the government is very clear whose rights and what it is. I just want to emphasize on this point. That is this responsibility of all that has happened on the Federation alone, or was it somewhere the fault of the provincial government
provincial
also?
Leaders also. Thank you for your comments, Ms. Ubaida Jalal. They are great. Some positive developments are clearly happening in Balochistan in addition to the challenges that have been discussed. Tariq Khosa Sahib has eloquently put forth. I just wanted to open the session for questions from the audience before we have to take a break.
Yeah, my name is Kaiser Bengali. I have just one question. A very large force has been raised for protection of CPEC. What percentage of that is from Balochistan?
Thank you very much. This large force which is being raised for the protection of CPAC and the projects, there's a part which comes from the already established security mechanism, the part of Army, part of FC, which is already there. But there are new wings being raised in Balochistan, and there will be a large percentage. We are still in the process of enrolling, and there will be a large percentage of people from Balochistan and from Sindh also, because that is also considered to be one of the deprived, sort of less represented in the armed forces. The process is on, but till now, whatever has been deployed for the protection, it is only the indigenous makeup of already existing security mechanism, whether it was the FC or the Army. But you'll see in the days to come, there would be a good representation from Balochistan itself.
General sir, I'd like to add, Kaiser Bengali sir, there is a recent decision which the government has taken, which is a very positive one, that we are going to have a four-lane highway from Chaman to Karachi. So this is part of the CPAC. in the context of connectivity, and this entire route will have proper motorway police and that aspects, and the people from Balochistan will be inducted. It is important. The FC battalions that he has talked about, I understand there is a component of Baloch youth which will be inducted, but it's a central military organization right from Gilgit-Baltistan up till Gwadar. They are raising different, you know, corps for this protection. But there is certainly an element of Baloch youth which is going to be inducted in this establishment.
Any more?
I'm Ejaz Ali Khwaja. My question is about the 18th Amendment, which, madam, you have discussed. Your government is trying to roll back 18th Amendment. Is it on the card, or what you say about that?
No such thing on the cards. This is how the opposition normally plays on the sentiments of the people of Pakistan, and which is really dangerous, because if we are all here for Pakistan, I don't think false statements should be made by any party.
I would like to add that, 18th Amendment, if any government tries to tinker with that or go into the 18th Amendment, I think it will be a great disservice. So from that point of view, 18th Amendment is provincial autonomy, and from a constitutional perspective. However, there is a mechanism within the 18th Amendment of rectification, of streamlining certain aspects of procedures that is very much inbuilt within the 18th Amendment. And from that forum, whether it's the government or judiciary and other interpretations can be undertaken, but I don't think any government is going to really sabotage this 18th Amendment.
I would just like to add on, we in the assembly, you're hearing voices of now this South Punjab for it to come into being. And within that also, you'll be hearing voices from the people of the state of Bahawalpur, who want a separate province. So it's more devolution that is going to happen. And then with the local governments coming into place, inshallah, soon, you will find that they'll be more empowered from just the political statements that were made in the past decade by having your local governments in place, but not actually authorizing or devolving even the financial aspects of it for them to be autonomous and empowered to do what they want. So you see, as Tariq Saab again mentioned, more devolution, and the mechanisms are being worked on according to the constitution.
But my fear is that this local government system, in its true spirit, the way it was visualized in KP and others, is not going to take that shape in other provinces or Punjab and other places. There are certain elements and vested interests who are more interested in taking over these local governments rather than from the local representatives themselves. Balochistan has completed its tenure of local governments. New elections are going to be due. So it's a defining moment. A very important third tier of government, which is local government, should be the most effective tier. And that is where our successive governments have let down the people, and they have just kept it at the provincial and federal level.
Thank you. Maybe one last question.
It is a very different question. The Kurds of the Middle East and in Iran, do they have any racial or historical connection to the Baloch people?
Yes, they do. My husband is a Kurd, so I think I'll answer that. They do have relations, even on the political linkages, in the sense of the... It's called the Kurd liberation kind of a movement. I don't exactly remember. But they also have links with the Kurds of Pakistan. It is there. Relations in the sense, the Kurds, according to one of the Italian archaeologists, have been on this land in Pakistan, in the subcontinent, since the last 1500 years, and specifically in Balochistan, 1300 years, specifically in Balochistan and Kashmir. So the linkage is there, the language is completely different. The Kurds here speak Brahvi, they don't speak the Kurdish language, but the language is similar again, and they have contacts, they do have contacts. Yeah.
Ethnic?
G? Irani, Turkish, and the Iraqi Kurds.
The Irani Baloch province, Sistan, Balochistan, has definite linkage with our province. There are, you know, interconnections and other aspects. There are some apprehensions within Iran, also from incursions across the border of some militant activity. From that point of view, I think we should also safeguard our national interests as far as our neighbors are concerned. So a peaceful 905 kilometers border with Iran should remain peaceful, and we should have good relations with that country.
Thank you very much. Any last comments before we wrap up? I think time is up.
I would just say that the beauty of discussion is that you can come up with all the arguments and the counter arguments in favor of your own viewpoint, of course. Why I said that we should admit that mistakes were there, and from everybody, and from every institution. Not only if I'm not talking about the state, I'm not talking of the military institution, I'm not talking about the intelligence, about the provincial government, whatsoever, everybody took part in those mistakes. But then there is an overwhelming tendency of blaming the military establishment everywhere also. And it was because the military did not have any spokesperson, or the military did not have its own language to protect everywhere on all the forums. As you can see on the panel itself, while Khosa Saab said that Abdul Malik Baloch was denied to have direct talks with few dissident elements, Dr. Zubeda Jalal Saiba said that once he was elected, it was because of the military establishment who came to his help for his elections. So you see, there's a difference of opinion everywhere. I'm glad that I have been able to bring that difference of opinion in my book also. That difference of opinion exists between the viewpoints of the tribal elders or the sardars, a few of the sardars who would say that the sardari system is so good for the betterment of people, and few sardars would say that it is no good for the betterment of people. Few militant elements and the organizations would say that we are on the right path and what we are doing is for the liberation of our people, while the others would say that what we are doing is totally on the behest of the foreign elements and foreign funding. So you see, this is the kind of difference of opinion. And unless we open up our minds to all kinds of difference of opinion, we would not be able to make a proper way forward. And I would say that if a small percentage of people in whole of Pakistan and in Balochistan in particular, they realize that, okay, this is a fraction of the way forward that we can look for, and then we can act upon it. This may give us a ray of hope towards a better future for our generations. Thank you very much.
Umair,
thank
you. I have one-liner for this book. Coming from a serving military general, this book is like a breath of fresh air.
Thank you. Thank you very much, General Fida Saab, Dr. Zubeda Jalal, Khosa Saab. Thank you for your time. Thank you, everybody, for coming to the session. And time is up. I think we will be moving on to our next session in the next 5-6 minutes.